is Kim Razor. My steampunk name is Baroness Violet von Nicholsburg. I run a blog at Steam and Genius. And my whole story, I basically got into costuming through steampunk 4 years ago. I never used a sewing machine, never made anything, and I started making my costumes, started making corsets, and corsets are my favorite thing in the world to make. I'm obsessed with corsets. I think about making corsets all the time. I'm not, you know, the hugest authority in the world. I don't know everything about corset making, but I hear a lot of people, even experienced seamstresses, talk about how hard it is to make corsets and how unpleasant, and they hate doing it. And I'm like, I think you're doing it wrong. Because I think if you go about it the right way and with the right attitude, it's a lot easier than people think. So that's kind of why I do this panel at lots of different cons, steampunk cons, anime cons, and that kind of thing. So I have a question for y'all. How many people here have actually made corsets before? Okay, so a lot of you, which is kind of what I thought. Usually I'm like, what's a corset? So I'm going to skip some of the what a corset is stuff, because, you know, and we've got 2 hours. I usually have only an hour. I'm usually talking really fast and trying to get through everything. So we'll have time for questions, and I'll go into a little more detail on some stuff. So if there's specific questions you have or problems you've had, we can talk about that at the end. But also, you know, feel free to throw something out there if, you know, you have a different take or tip or something on a topic. So we pretty much all know what corsets are. I'm mostly going to be talking about Victorian-style corsets. Most modern corsets are also the same Victorian hourglass shape. You know, pre-Victorian corsets tend to be very different. I don't have a lot of experience in them. And, you know, that you tend to use different materials, different shapes and stuff. So mostly we're talking about Victorian and later corsets. Okay, the different types of corset: overbust, which would be covering the full bust; mid-bust, most Victorian period corsets are mid-bust, so they sit right at the nipple line. And a lot of patterns, historical patterns that you'll find, or modern patterns based on Victorian patterns, they only come up to the nipple line. So if you want it to be higher, if you want more coverage, you need to raise that up. So that's something you need to know going into making the corset. And there's also underbust corsets, which just stop right there. Okay, and I'm sure we've all heard myths, a lot of different myths about corsets, which I'd like to just briefly say aren't true. First one that you hear the most is that corsets are painful. Not if you're wearing the right corset. And that's why I make my own custom corsets, because I couldn't find any that fit me correctly off the rack. Some people, if you have the right figure, you can. If your figure is more difficult to fit, then you almost have to go with the custom made, which is why I started making my own. But if corset is actually painful and causing you pain, take the thing off because there's something wrong. You can't breathe in a corset. The first thing anybody says to me is, "Can you breathe in that?" Okay, this is my waist. These are my lungs. They're two completely different areas, okay? I can stick my whole hand down the front. There's plenty of room for me to breathe. You can't be active in a corset. I wear corsets every day because I have a back problem, and I wear them for back support. I clean my house in a corset. I sew in a corset. I do, you know, most of my activities wearing a corset. I go shopping in a corset. I wouldn't go run a race in one, or, you know, exercise, but other than that, you know, you're not as limited as a lot of people think you are. Okay, so that's my little intro. I'm going to talk about materials to use making a corset, and the first one is boning. There's two kinds of steel boning, which is spiral steel boning, which looks like this, or this, or this. And as you can see, it's very flexible, and it springs back. It doesn't get bent. And it comes in different widths. This is the half inch. This is quarter inch. Flat steel, which is also called spring steel. I don't use the term spring steel because I think because this kind of looks like a spring, it gets confusing to some people. So I call this spiral steel and flat steel. And it's also very bendable, but it doesn't bend at all side to side. It only bends this way. And there's different thicknesses and strengths of flat steel also. But you want to use flat steel, particularly around the grommets at the back of a corset, or at the front of the corset if you're not also using a busk. Some people, you can do a whole corset with flat steel, some people prefer it, but it's you get a less curvy and less form-fitting shape from it. And then there's plastic boning. Okay, I bring this as my corset of horrors. This was bought off eBay for about $10. And I'll show you the kind of boning that's in it.
Zip ties?
No. I think I don't even know what this is.
Zip ties would probably be stronger.
I have this is a zip tie, it's way stronger. This is like a plastic drinking straw. Okay. it's horrible. I mean, but you can see with plastic boning, the big problem, besides the fact that this is really, really weak and cleansing, is that once it gets bent, it stays bent, and then that's going to be poking you in the ribs all day, and it's going to be really uncomfortable, which is why a lot of people buy a cheap corset, put it on, it doesn't fit them correctly, and then the plastic boning gives out and is poking them all day, and they're like, wow, corsets are really painful. No. There's a problem with the corset you're wearing. So that's my don't buy one of these. Plastic, the only plastic boning, if for some reason you really want to use plastic boning, that I would ever recommend is heavy-duty plastic cable ties, which is what this is. I don't use them in actual corsets, I use them for mock-ups, but I don't know, if you need to go through a metal detector in a corset, or there's some reason that you have to have boning right now and you can only get to the hardware store, okay, heavy-duty cable ties. I just found out they make metal cable ties also that are steel. I don't know. I might want to use some of those.
I use them in between my steel and steel plastic, steel plastic.
Yeah, you can do that. And I've known people to do that too, just to sort of stretch their money and everything.
$7 for a huge thing of cable ties.
Yeah, I mean, I paid like $1.50 for a big long thing, and I just keep cutting them down because I use them in all my mock-ups. But so if you're going to use plastic, this is the strongest. Don't go to the sewing store and buy the boning they have there. Just don't do it. It's not worth anything. But in my opinion, if you're going to go through all the trouble of making a corset and all the time and energy, use the right materials because you'll get something that will last and that you'll be happy with and you'll be comfortable. You're going to put all that work into something. Okay, let's talk briefly about cutting and tipping bones. Because the cheapest way to buy steel boning is in a roll. The first time I made a corset, I bought it, you can order each piece a certain length. I need two that are 14.5 inches, and they come pre-tipped and everything. But it can get very expensive to do it that way. I think I spent $70 on my first corset for some supplies. It's much cheaper to buy it on a roll and cut it and tip it yourself. So the way to cut boning is you need a boning cutter, which is also known as a cable cutter. However, you can't just go to the hardware store and pick up any cable cutter, because I tried that. Even if it says it's for cutting metal cable, make sure it says it cuts steel, because there's ones out there that cut copper wiring and that kind of stuff, but they're not made for steel, and this will chew up the blade like butter. So I was going to bring mine, but I didn't. I got one from CorsetMaking.com, which is a good one. But it is just a cable cutter, if you can find the right style. And with it, you just cut it, and it's much easier than trying to do it with any other tool, trust me. And then there's tipping. which is kind of, there's several different ways to tip. The traditional way is that phones are often sold with these little U-shaped metal bits. And I hate them. The way you're supposed to put it on is take, you know, two pliers, and you have to bend the metal tip over the end and then crush it. And they make little dies for some grommet machines. They're kind of hard to find to fit certain machines. But anyway, it's a real pain in the butt to put them on. And they, once you get them on, a lot of times they just come right off. As a matter of fact, I was making one of these samples yesterday, the day before yesterday, and I slid a bone in there and I decided I wanted to use a different one. Pulled it out and the little U thing got stuck right in my boning channel. So I hate using those. I don't do it. This is one that was in the course that I bought, and it was, you know, professionally done. And that it still came off at the end. So the other ways to tip bones, this one was tipped with what's called tool dip, which is a rubberized plastic that you would, say, dip a hammer handle into to make it rubberized and grip. Plastidest is the brand name. And I tried it, as you can see. I didn't really like it because I had to do a couple of different dips to really get a good layer on there, and then you have to let them dry. And I'm really impatient. So the other thing you can do, and especially this is good if you're stuck at home and you're trying to finish something at the last minute and you need to cut a bone, you can use plumber's thread tape, which doesn't have any adhesive on it, just sticks to itself. And you wrap it around the end, really, and you pull it tight, so you wrap it and it sticks to itself. And this one's actually been in a corset, and because of the pressure, it's pretty much like a solid thing now. So I've used that a lot, especially when I'm in a hurry. And plumber's thread tape is extremely cheap. But I just found a new method that I'm in love with, which is, heat shrink tubing. Get it at the hardware store. It's for electronics. And it comes in a roll. It comes in all different thicknesses. I buy the quarter inch wide because I'm using mostly quarter inch phones. And then you just cut a little piece off the tubing, then put it on the end of your bone and hold it over a candle flame and turn it so it gets all on each side, and the tube just shrinks down to the size of the bone. And then you take pliers and close the end off, and then trim the end so it's nice and as close as you can without opening it back up, and make it nice, and that's what it looks like. Heat shrink tubing. Allegi Electrical.
You can get it at Fry's.
Fry's has a good selection.
Yeah, or if you have Harbor Freight, is where I buy mine, because I just always go there because it's cheap. And they have it. You know, and it's a couple of bucks for a few of it or something like that. I'm like, the last time I went, I was like, don't they come in bigger rolls? Because I don't know so much of it. So it's really fast. You can just cut, do it, you're done. I love it.
How is it as rubbery as the plastic dip? I paint the ends of mine with nail polish sometimes to make them smoother so they don't have the channels.
That's a good idea. Yeah. It's a little rubbery, but yeah, if you did paint it, it would be smoother.
Because when the channels are tight, sometimes it's hard.
Yeah, that's the other thing about the plastic dip I don't like, is it makes it really rubbery and it's hard to slide through. I haven't really had problems with this because it's so form-fitted. But then again, I'm usually filming things up there. Okay. Oh, and then we'll also, this is a busk. This is what goes front of most corsets, unless you have a closed front or a waist up front. And they come in different strengths and different widths, and of course lots of different lengths. But I really prefer having busks at the front over anything else because it makes corsets much easier to get into and out of. No matter how cool it might look to have a nice closed front corset, you still have to get laced up the back, and it's a pain. But with a busk, I can get into a corset in, you know, 45 seconds. I'm used to it. The other thing is, they do make 2-inch wide busks that are double this width on each side, and I highly recommend those if you're very curvy or busty, because I had a corset, like I said, I wear a corset every day. I have one that I wore every day, and I had a busk that was a good quality, regular busk, but, you know, nice quality. And I wore it in one corset till that corset wore out. Then I took the busk and put it in a new corset, and I wore that one for, so I was probably wearing that busk for a year and a half, and it snapped in the middle. Like, just because I'm very curvy at the front here, and it just got more and more and more bends over time, and eventually snapped in half. It didn't hurt me or anything, I didn't even notice it until I took it off, but it did happen. Now I have the really wide one, it's awesome. It's a lot more support, it's easier to get into. So if you are really curvy like that, I recommend the wide ones. Okay, let's talk about fabric. The most important fabric in your corset is the strength fabric. That's where the actual strength of the corset comes from. There's basically two fabrics I'm gonna recommend you use for strength fabric. The first is coutil, which is fabric made specifically for corsetry. It's extremely strong. I didn't bring my coutil. Another thing I forgot. It's usually cotton. It's a very dense herringbone weave. And it has basically zero stretch to it. No direction. This stuff, you can just stand it up and it'll stand up on its own. It's great. It's also really thin and pretty smooth. So, you know, you can, it actually makes a smooth finish and lightweight. The only problem with coutil is that it's expensive. Which, you know, I mean, $20 a yard is a really good deal on coutil, which I've gotten, but, you know, so you're looking at sometimes $25, $30 a yard. If it's specialty coutil, like satin coutil or printed, it can be way more expensive. So, if you're just starting out, you probably don't want to be using that if you are worried you might be making mistakes or you just want to try it out. It depends, you know, sometimes I use coutil, sometimes I use cotton duck, which is basically your low-cost alternative. You know, you can use cotton duck, make just that you get at the fabric store. I go to the remnant bin and get whatever's in there, because it doesn't matter what it looks like, it's just going to be on the inside of the corset. The only thing to keep in mind is make sure you don't get the outdoor duck that's treated with chemicals to repel sunlight and water, because you don't want fabric that's repelling water against your skin. You would probably die from not breathing.
Can you?
Yeah. It's also more expensive usually. Usually you can tell because it's like two or three times as expensive as the regular stuff. I just try to avoid it, but I've never. I'm always afraid of chemicals getting on me. But anyway, just try to make sure you get the regular stuff, because it's usually cheaper anyway. And like I said, I go to the remnant pen, and I don't care what it looks like.
One comment?
Yeah.
I've done a corset, and I am a curly individual as well. And I've used denim, a really good, strong denim. This corset has held up for 20 years. So, but you want a quality fabric. Something that when you relax it and then stretch it, it goes thump.
Yeah, you want it to have as little stretch as possible. And a lot of denim is thin and some of it has stretch in it.
That's why I said look for the thump.
Yeah, some people also use twill, a heavy twill. And I've used that as lining. Sort of as a backup strength fabric and a lining. But there's also grain issues with twill because it's got a diagonal grain. It can, if you don't make sure you're alternating the diagonal grain, it can make the corset twist. So that's something.
Cut it like that so that there's.
Right, so that the grain is pulling against each other basically. So because of that, I avoid it just because that's an extra thing to worry about. So I just use the duck. You can use other things, but I think in general people found that those are the easiest.
I use upholstery weight cotton because it has to be dimensionally stable.
I would probably add a layer of that to that too. I really like maybe sturdy corsets, because I'm really hard on my corsets.
Yeah.
I mean, it depends on what you're wearing it for. If you're going to wear it once, you know, that's, or you're just wearing it, you know, for a reenactment thing, or, you know, I wear mine a lot, and I wear through them, so I really try to make them as sturdy as possible. Then the fashion fabric, okay, the pretty stuff on the outside. You know, if you're just making a basic underwear corset, you can just have coutil on the outside. I don't usually recommend having duck on the outside because it's really rough. And if you're wearing it, say, just around the house, and your arms are rubbing on it, I have worn places on my arms from doing that. So I always try to at least cover it with just cotton or something. But you can use whatever for the outside of the corset. Some things are easier to use than others. Generally, the heavier the fabric is, the easier it is to work with as a fashion fabric. So a home decor, a brocade, jacquard, those are really nice fabrics to use on the outside because they don't wrinkle as much. But there's plenty of people who use the nice thin silks. They're just a little more difficult because they tend to wrinkle more. Satin is really difficult. It really shows all the wrinkles, which you can get around. A lot of corset makers will take, if you're using a thinner fabric, will fuse it to either a good woven interfacing or use a fusible web and fuse it directly to coutil. So you have like one layer of really strong and pretty fabrics, which can make it very stiff too. Sometimes you don't like it. Sometimes it's a little cardboardy if you do the fusing of two layers. But it's a personal preference thing. So I would recommend, if you're just starting out, to try to use a heavier fabric, like a jacquard or brocade or more home decor fabric. Just because it's got less stretch, it'll wrinkle less. It'll just be a little smoother. And you don't really want anything that stretches as your fashion fabric. Lining fabric, I usually just use regular 100% cotton. You want something that will breathe, so you don't want to use the stupid poly lining fabric from the store. Some people will use silk, but I don't think it breathes as well as cotton, and you won't stay as cool, even though it feels nice against your skin. That's really sort of more for a boudoir corset. I've used just regular old quilting cotton. You can use whatever print. You can have a fun Island Pony print on the inside. I also like using cotton sateen as my favorite fabric right now on the inside because you got the nice smooth, nice sateen against your skin, and it's got a heavier weight than quilting cotton, so it's just sort of a little more sturdy. But again, you can use whatever you want. Okay, other materials, we talked about busks, grommets for lacing. There's basically two sizes. You want to use the two-part grommets, not eyelets that just have the one side. So you want to use the two-part ones. The two sizes are size 0 and size 00. Size 00 are smaller. I always use size 0, which are these, because I like using paracord to lace my corsets, and it doesn't go through the smaller ones. So I almost always use size 0 grommets. You can buy kits with grommets that come with the little center metal piece and the anvil, and you just hammer on that. And that's the cheapest and honestly probably the best and most secure way to install grommets. It's a little more time consuming than trying to use grommet presses. I've never bought a grommet press because the ones that are affordable, I've heard, are not very good. There's really expensive big ones that I'd love to have one, but most of those are out of the range of somebody working at home. I do have a whole tutorial on my blog on exactly how to set grommets the right way, that's so that they never come out. I've never had a grommet pop out.
Do you have a method that doesn't involve cursing?
It usually involves cursing.
Okay, I thought so.
What size of awl do you recommend? Because with the size 0, I found I can't get the hole big enough for the grommet.
What I do is I use the awl to make the hole, mm-hmm. And then I take a chopstick and shove it through the hole to make the hole bigger. And I usually push it through from the front, pull the chopstick all the way through, and then I put it through from the back and put the grommet on it.
Okay.
And then that's how I get the grommet in the hole. It's a little, like, fiddly. It depends on the fabrics, too, how hard they are to stretch.
Yeah, because if you want one for multiple layers, it's really...
Yeah, it takes a little force. Like I said, but when you do it that way, they are not coming out.
I use a fabric punch, which is great when it works, but also get dull really fast. And then
you can punch holes. I've done a couple.
I had the hammer one.
Yeah, right. They have the hammer ones. Yeah. I did some with the hand punch because I had some fabric that was really difficult to get through. The only problem is that those are, if you cut a hole, you still want to make a hole smaller than the grommet and stretch from there. Because if you just cut the hole the size of the grommet, it's going to be loose and it may pop out. And I hear about people having these grommets pop out of their corsets. It's never happened to me. So, you definitely want to start with a very small hole and stretch it.
So when you pull the chopstick through, you put the grommet on the end so that it stays?
Yeah.
I'll have to try that. That's a good
idea. Yeah, I mean, I just have, it's in my little toolbox. And it's all pencils
and pencils.
Yeah.
Well,
I have
chopsticks
are
the ones that
were
very hard to find.
Those are hard to find.
That is something with a tapestry. And the regular grommets are just too short, no matter how hard I hit them.
And I had that problem with the corset I'm going to wear tonight.
Yeah, I think I found them at Barthagale's.
Yeah.
They were pricey. Mm-hmm. But you cannot buy them locally. You have to order them.
I've never even gotten them, but yeah, they're hard to find. I had to end up changing my fabric to get my grommets through this one project I did. I buy a lot of my grommets from corsetmaking.com. They've got a lot of different colors. Like, they've got antique gold, antique silver, black, white, gold, regular silver. And they're good quality. Corsetmaking.com. They sell pretty much all corset supplies. Some of their stuff is better quality than others of their stuff, but the grommets that's pretty much where I buy my grommets.
Yeah. And if you're in a rush, like you need them tomorrow or today, you can, and you don't care what color they are, Tandy Leather carries the size that you're...
Yeah,
I don't think they're quite as good a quality as what you're going to get at CorsetMaking.com, but if you haven't...
I think they're okay quality because I've gotten theirs, but I think they're expensive.
Yeah, that's true.
Everything at Tandy Leather is very expensive.
Yeah.
I know these things.
That's true, but,
then they have a place in a big store here in town. Yes.
What do you want?
I can give out the handouts, but it's basically links to more information online.
And they also does a discount.
Yeah, they do.
Yeah, if you join their thing.
Actually, for clubs, the costume guild should be able to get one.
Thank you.
Yesterday, this one. Pack it up another reenactment group to get one.
That's good enough. Okay, and then finally, lacing. Like I said, I really like to use paracord as lacing because it's cheap. It's easy to find. It comes in a million different colors. And it goes through the grommets really, really easily. It's really easy to lace yourself with it because you just pull and it just pulls right through. It's not the most delicate looking thing, but it doesn't bother me. Regular corset lacing is a flat lace that looks like a shoelace, but it's very strong. You probably have to order that from a corset site like corsetmaking.com or pretty much any corset supply site. And other people do like to use ribbon because it's pretty. You have to make sure you have very strong double satin ribbon. I don't like using it because it's really hard to lace. Like, you have to pull each little loop just right, and since he's usually lacing me in, he hates it. He's like, don't even get me near a ribbon, which is why I switched to this, because it's really easy.
What are you
I usually order it online, but in a big thing. Amazon.com has it with a bunch of different colors. You can also get it at military surplus stores or academy. But I think it's cheapest if you just, there's a whole site that you can order huge amounts in a million colors. I think it's like paracord.com, but don't quote me on that. But you can Google it. But it comes in, of course, camouflage and bright pink and whatever. pink camouflage. Okay, so getting into corset patterns. If you're going to use a pre-made pattern for your corset, most of the specialty corset companies or costuming pattern companies, their corset patterns are going to be better than your Simplicity, Butterix, etc. The Laughing Moon 100 pattern is very popular. It's got two different corset patterns in there, one that's a straight front and one that has bust gores. And they're both Victorian patterns. The other one is Truly Victorian 110. It's supposed to be extremely good. I haven't used that one.
It's really good to scale.
Yeah, and I just heard it goes together really nicely, and it's easy to fit.
And if you email the person who makes them, she will email you back.
Oh, she's very nice. Yeah, and I've used a lot of Truly Victorian patterns. I mean, they're all really good. I haven't used that corset pattern, but I hear great things about it. But if you're going to use a mainstream pattern company pattern, you can do that. You have to make sure, first of all, go down two sizes automatically. They're all way too big. They leave like ease in the pattern for a corset which needs negative ease. So you have to jump in just when you start out, look at the chart and go two sizes down. This was actually a buttering pattern before I modified it a lot. I like to modify patterns. I was the first mock-up I made. I went down one size because I thought, well, surely that'll be fine. I don't know why I did that. It was a very nice bodice. It wasn't a corset, though. I was like, well, it fits nice. It's just lots of room.
I had to take the unbust Simplicity one.
Uh-huh.
I made it to their sizes, and it was 2 inches too big.
Yeah.
I already made the entire corset. I had to take it completely apart and cut it out.
Yeah.
It was... And it's really hard to fit your corset on you when it's not completely made.
Yeah. License strips.
Yeah, that's why mock-ups are so important. I'm going to talk about that in just a minute. You don't want to get to that point of having made a whole corset and it doesn't fit.
That's
it's heartbreaking.
The customers.
Well, I have lacing strips so I can base them on.
Yeah, I got like these.
Yeah.
Those are my lacing strips. They were part of a corset at one time. But this is a mock-up. This is the last mock-up I've made. And so you don't have to grommet each individual mock-up you make. Just make panels like this. It actually has a cable ties. And then I just baste it onto the back of each mock-up so I don't have to re-grommet it each time because that's a huge amount of time. But anyway, back to patterns. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
When I did mine, the corset patterns were not in popularity yet. So the chief that the person that was teaching me how to do it was very much into historical, said, buy a wedding dress pattern that has the lines that you want for the period that you want. Because if you take a look at the bodices of a lot of wedding dress patterns, they have historical lines. And then what you do is you don't cut on the cutting line. You cut on the stitching line, and that will take the ease out. And that will get you something reasonably close, and that's easier to modify very readily. That's what we wound up doing, because there weren't corset patterns.
Mm-hmm.
And if you get somebody who doesn't fit the standard corset sizes that are out there in the pattern companies, the wedding dresses are typically made for 2X, 3X.
Well, that's a good thing about the Truly Victorian patterns, is they go up very large. I mean,
she's a big lady.
Yes, she is a plus size lady, and I think there's actually there's an addendum for the plus for the very large sizes. You buy the regular pattern, and it goes up to size like 24. But then if you need higher, there's another addendum you can buy. to add to it. So it really does cover pretty much every size, which is one of the nice things about truly good thing. Talking about modifying a pattern, the easiest way, this is the sort of cheating way to get a pattern to fit you better, is instead of looking at the little chart on the pattern and saying, okay, I think the measurements that are closest to mine are a size 12, and I'm going to make a size 12. What you want to do is make sure you have your exact measurements, that you've taken your measurements correctly for bust waisting, unless you're not using the bust because you're doing it under bust. And then look at exactly what size each of those measurements is. Your bust may be a size 14, and your waist is a size 10, and your hips are a size 18. And then when you go to make your pattern, use that part of the pattern piece that's for the size that actually fits you. So if your bust is actually a size 18, draw the lines for size 18. Draw the hip lines for the size that you actually are. And if you want the waist smaller, you can always go into a size down from where you are on the waist. So that now you have a custom pattern very quickly that's going to fit you a lot better than just a size that's sort of average in the middle of those. Does that make sense? If there was a chalkboard, I'd draw you a little thing. and that's another way also to, if you're trying to get a smaller waist, is to go down in the waist area and when you're actually transferring your pattern. So when you have one of these multi-size patterns, you know, you can choose what size you want each part of the corset to be. The other thing is, if you are trying to get a smaller waist, you want to make the hips and the bust bigger. Because, you know, we can't just squeeze the human body and squeeze the human body. There's limits to how much you can squeeze.
Conservation of mass.
That conservation of mass. The flesh has to have somewhere to go. So I always make my hips really pretty loose. Because that way you can push some of the waist and tummy down into that part of the corset and get the nice waist. But you should definitely, that's what you should play around with in the mock-ups, which we're going to talk about.
I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
I haven't made one yet, but I have all the supplies for one. One problem I have with the ready-made ones is especially the bust measurement, the placement between how much fabric is in the back and how much fabric is in the front of the corset, they assume you're made
all over. Yeah.
so how do you mess with the pattern to kind of not have, because the one I have right now, I can basically close it all the way to the top and I still have enough room in the bust. If that makes sense.
Yeah. And that's when you get into doing more modification to the pattern for you specifically. In that case, I would increase the size of the pieces in the front. So I would maybe, you know, copy a size 22 bust line for the first three panels and leave the back panels at a size 18, you know? There's also other ways that you can draft patterns. I'll talk about that in a little bit. You just want to add to just those areas of the pattern pieces. I mean, I've done that when you have your pattern piece, like on this one, it's very busty. I added, you know, I had a pattern piece that just sort of went like this, and I just added a quarter inch to each size because I knew I needed more room just right in the cup. So it's just a matter of sort of making those modifications to the pattern, then making the mock-ups and trying it out and seeing how it works. So it's a more involved process, but to get that perfect fit. but if you don't want to use a commercial pattern, you can draft a corset pattern from your own measurements. You can draft it from scratch, which is a little more advanced, but there's really good tutorials on the website Foundations Revealed that are free. And you can get their tutorials for drafting from your measurements. It involves math, rulers. I'm not a math person, but trust me, I'm doing so much math because to make corsets. But one thing you can do is, if you have a pattern that you like, but it doesn't fit you, it's not in your size at all, you have a historical pattern from, there's different corset books that have historical patterns, or you can go on patent websites and download these historical corset patterns, and you know, they're a size 20 waist, and you're like, that's never gonna fit me. There is also a tutorial on Foundations Revealed on taking an existing pattern and making it to fit your exact measurements. And it ends up, okay, this is a historical pattern, Victorian pattern from Jill Saline's book, Corsets. And this is all the math. But if the idea, I'm not gonna go through the whole process, because it's long, but the idea is, you've got each corset piece, and it's got a line down the middle of each one, and you've got your waistline, you've got your bust line, you've got your hip line. And you measure what the width of each of these pieces are. So this right here is 11 centimeters. I did this one a while ago. But yeah, it's like, you know, 9 centimeters, 5 centimeters. Maybe this is millimeters because it's so small. And then you figure out, you've got the front waist, back waist, front bust, front hip, back hip, which addresses the issues you're talking about of, you know, you need more in the back, in the bottom, or you need more in the front. You know, we're all sort of built very differently. And so you measure the corset, and then you say, okay, this measurement is 26% of the front bust. And you go along, you do all this math on your little pattern. Then you take your actual measurements and you say, my front bust is, you know, 13 inches. So 26% of that is this big. And you go and you plot it out. And you end up with a pattern that uses the same style as your original pattern, but the proportions are for your figure. And it works out really pretty well. But that's, I mean, obviously that's a more advanced way of making a corset pattern. But that's one way to do it that I've found works pretty well. Did that make any sense? Okay. It does entail math, but it's only really adding and percentage. I have a calculator. I hate math, but I
it comes in handy if you need like a style of corset that they really don't make, like your Edwardian spoon.
Yeah, that's what, if you really have a historical style that you want to make, and there's not a pattern for it. That's where I started with this one.
And they have like patents of corsets, so it's actually,
there's crazy patents out there.
No patents. When they have the patents, and you can look up corset patents on Google Books, and they have like lots of them from the 19th, and
they're all they're weird. I mean, there's a million of them.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's talk about making a mock-up, because this is the most important step. Yes.
Just a quick, what did you say you use normally as your base pattern in the beginning?
It varies.
Okay.
The first time I used the Laughing Loon 100 door corset. Was my first corset I made.
I guess that's more the question. If you haven't done it before, and
I think I would really recommend the Truly Victorian 110, just because I've heard such good things about it from first-time corset makers. I have never personally used it because every time I make a corset, I want to do something completely different. Mm-hmm. So I end up doing things like this, or this is a pattern that I just made myself. So that's getting a little more advanced, but I would probably recommend the Truly Victorian. Okay. So the most important part is once you have a pattern that theoretically fits you, or should be close to fitting you, you have to make a mock-up before you go to the real corset. You don't want to go through all the corset making process with all your good fabric and end up, it's not going to fit you right. This is my third mock-up. I almost always end up making three, just because if I don't, I end up with something I'm not 100% happy with.
And it's really adorable. I can tell she's made one when I come home from work and she's like, oh good, you're home. Come here.
You walked in the door. Here's the camera. Okay, I need to get, you need to tie me in this and we need to take pictures of it.
But the cats, no.
You can use really any non-stretchy fabric. I've just used sheets from the thrift store and cable ties, you know, if you want to go for the very basic materials for using your mock-up. The closer the fabric you use for your mock-up is to what you're going to be making the corset out of, you know, the better it's going to really show you how that corset's going to look. I've made mock-ups out of duck before. But when it comes down to it, you know, do you really want to use all of your fabric for your mock-ups? Because I've gone through all of my duck making mock-up after mock-up. Like, this is some pink stuff I had. It's sort of like a heavy...
That stuff off the roll.
Yeah. And I wasn't going to do anything with my bubblegum pink fabric, so I used it for this. I've used, like, leftover curtain fabric and whatever. And then, like I said, I usually use the cable ties for most of the boning, except around the bust and the hips, if the hips are very curvy, because I'll use the spiral to really get a sense of how that's going to be shaped, of how it's really going to curve. And we were talking about the lacing bones. You need to make yourself some of these so you can just sew them on the back and lace it up. And then when you're done with this one, you make the next mock-up, you just seam ripper them off and sew it on the next one. So once you have your mock-up, like Justin was saying, you need to take some pictures of you wearing it. Get it on, make sure it's laced correctly, as well as it can be, and then get someone to take pictures of you in it, from the front, from the side, and especially from the back, because you won't be able to see what it looks like in the back, and that's a really good way of telling how a corset fits. Ideally, a corset in the back should have the two sides should be parallel. They should be straight up and down, and the distance between them should be the same all the way up and down. Often, it's not going to be that way, especially on your first mock-up. You may have a big gap at the top, you know, or it's closed all the way at the bottom, and that's when you know, okay, I have to take some out of the hips. I have to add some in the bust area. And then, like, I just basically will put the mock-up on and stand in front of the mirror for a really long time and then pinch and see where is there excess, you know, this needs to come out, or I need to add more in the bust because it's really flat. And then there's two ways, basically, to change from the mock-up. You can actually make changes directly to your mock-up, especially if you need to take out from your fabric. You know, you can pinch it and pin it, and then I just like put darks in it, and then take your mock-up apart and use that as your pattern to draw your new pattern from the changes you made to it. I also usually make marks on it, like there's actually marks on here, like this is where my ribs are, this needs to go in here, or, you know, if I need to take some out from the hip, I'll take a magic marker and draw, this is where the new line needs to be. And the other thing you can do is just go back to your pattern and say, okay, I know I need to add some more to the bust. I think I need to add about half an inch, you know, so I'll add a quarter inch on this seam, a quarter inch on that seam. And then you make another mock-up and try out how that worked. And like I said, it seems to be, I tend to make three. Which some people say is a lot. But in my experience, if I make two, I'll make a first one, and I'm like, well, that's pretty good, but it definitely needs changes in the bust, it definitely needs this. I'll change it, and then I'm like, okay, well, that's good, but I want to add some more to the top and the bottom, and maybe this one change to the back. And if I don't make another mock-up, I make the corset, and then I'm like, damn, it doesn't fit perfectly right here, or I wish I would have done this or that. So that's why I usually end up making a third one, just to say, okay, these are my final changes, this is the final pattern I'm going to use as my corset, and this is exactly what it's going to look like. You also want to sit down in the maca and make sure it's not too long so it's not hitting the tops of your thighs. Because if it does that, it's going to be very uncomfortable. Make sure it's comfortable when you're sitting down, you're not falling out the top of it. And then, you know, you may want to wear it for 20 minutes or so and just see if it gets uncomfortable, if it starts pinching somewhere around your ribs, so that you really have an idea of how it's going to feel when you make the real one. Yeah.
I was recently told a new tip on a maca. A friend was putting her her boning in duct tape and then taping it on her. Have you done that?
I have not done that.
Okay.
I heard that. I haven't tried it.
Yeah, I just heard of like several people who were doing that, and my only reservation, I was like, oh my God, that's brilliant, you know, because I could just rip them off and then, you know, and then take in my mock-up as needed, just right there.
Uh-huh.
But yeah, my only concern was, you know, when you're sewing those boning channels, a lot of times that's where you get a lot of wrinkling.
Uh huh.
And
I feel the same way, because when you're so, even though these are not sewn exactly the same way, I'm going to do my final one, and it's much messier and stuff like that. It does give you an idea of where you're going to have wrinkles, or if there's problems, you know, with the panels going together. And like you can see, it's basically just the seam allowances are folded over, and it's stitched in like some places, not particularly well stitched. And you can see my purple magic marker, which is my actual seam lines. So I can make sure that I'm actually stitching on the seam lines as drawn to try to get the best, most accurate fit. There was something else I was going to say that you reminded me of. Oh, the nice thing about doing a mock-up, if you haven't done corsets before, or if you're going to be trying a new construction method, you can make your mock-up your practice. You can try your method out of how you're going to sew it. So you learn what you're doing before you're messing with your actual fabric. So it's a good idea, if you're doing this for the first time, to try out whatever method you're going to use of actually constructing it, because it gives you that practice room. With the lacing bones, you can see I just split the back panel there to lace through. So that's how you attach the lacing bones. Okay, so actually constructing the corset. I'm going to talk about three different ways to construct a corset. There's a lot of different ways, and there's a lot of historical ways of construction. But I think if you're starting out, you haven't made a million corsets, there's basically three ways that you should choose from. And I'm going to go over the pros and cons of each one. The first is the sandwich method, which is kind of the instructions you'll find with most corset patterns. And it's sort of, I guess, the traditional way of making a corset. And what it is basically however many, you have at least two layers of your strength fabric. And you sew from the front to the back the entire one layer of the corset, stitch it all the seams together, and you sew the other layer from the front to the back. And you may have more layers. You may have four layers, because you may have fashion fabric layer, you may have a lining layer, but you have at least two that are your strength fabric. So then, once you have your layers done, then you attach them at the front and at the back, and you insert your busk, and you try to line up the seams of your layers. And some people will go in and baste through the seams to make sure all the seams are lined up. And then you stitch your corset, your channels for your bones. This one is done with a double boning on, so there's two bones each seam. But you can basically put the corset channels anywhere. You stitch one line, stitch the other line, and you have a channel. And the corset just slips between the two layers. So the pros of doing this method are that it's pretty easy to understand, fairly straightforward. You can put your bones anywhere because your strength fabric, there's two layers of it everywhere. And you can also, once you put that one total layer together, you can kind of fit it on yourself and make sure it's fitting correctly. Hold it up, and if you need to change it, then you can change it at that point because you haven't gone through all the boning that's been. The problems with this method are if you're not a very precise sewer, those seams may not match up correctly. If your seam allowances aren't perfect every time, when you go to match up your seams, they may not match up. This is my problem. And I did this one, I had another example, I lost it, so I did this one Thursday really quickly, which is why it's really messy. But you can see, my seams did not match up correctly. So when I stitched the boning channel, it's like all over here on the other side of the seam, because it's not matching up. So if you do have seams that don't match up, you end up with one layer that's buckling and causing wrinkles and not looking good at all. So you have to be really careful that you're stitching it very precisely, that each layer is stitched the same way, and then you match them up. Any questions on that one? That's the basic idea. I also think it takes a long time because you sew a whole layer, and you sew another whole layer, then you put them together, then you do your boning channels, and to me it feels like it takes forever to do. So I never use that method because, like I said, I'm not the most precise sewer in the world. I tried it once and I did end up with little wrinkles along the edges of the seams, and it wasn't attractive. Okay, the next method is to use external boning channels. And this is a very historical method. A lot of corsets were made this way, especially in the Edwardian period. The basic idea is that you have, you know, your strength layer, you have your corset, and you've constructed it, and then you make these little tubes of fabric and sew your little tubes and stitch them down to the front of the corset, and the bones slide into the tube. Fairly simple. In this example, I have the seams as stitched and pressed open like that in the back, but you can also make it so that right sides together in the inside, and you've got your seam allowances sticking out on the outside, and then you put the bone casing down over those seam allowances, so then the inside is nice and smooth. And it's a good way to make a one-layer corset that's really thin and smooth on the inside, and then you just have the bone on the outside. So that's one of the pros, is you can do a very thin one-layer corset that way. And it also looks nice. You can do nice contrasting channels, which always looks really good on a corset. You can also put, you know, the channels pretty much wherever you want. You don't have to put them just on the seams. Some, you know, like if you look at some Victorian corsets, they're all going weird diagonals and stuff like that, crossing across several panels. The cons of it are it's a little time-consuming and fiddly because you have to make all these little tubes, and especially if you're using, say you're using coutille and a fashion fabric, you have to, you know, put those two together and make the strips and then stitch the tubes together, and then, you know, make sure you're stitching them, make sure they're the right size for your bones with just enough room for you to stitch it down and the bone to fit in securely. So it's kind of, you know, you have to press them and get them down right and stitch them, and it's a little fiddly in my opinion. But it looks good. The only other problem with them is that if they're not as durable. I had a corset that was made with external bones like this, and like I said, I'm very hard on my corsets, and this is a corset that I ended up wearing a lot. It was underwear under Victorian clothing, and I also wore it around the house. And because it was just one layer of fabric covering the bone ended up poking through after a certain amount of time. So for me, I was like, well, I'm not doing that again because I don't want, you know, my bone to poke through the corset after a couple of months if putting that much time into it. So that's my opinion on that one. Questions on then we're going to get to the third method. My personal favorite method of putting a corset together. Now, this method doesn't really have a good name. It's been called the welt seam method. I don't like that name. It's not actually a welt seam. So I call it the folded seam method of corsets. I'm the only person in the world who calls it that, by the way. I'm trying to make it catch on. But I've literally heard people just call it like that way that you do it with the such and such. Okay, so
it's the beast method. It's the beast method.
And, okay, so the way it works is you're constructing the corset from the front to the back, all of the layers at the same time. So, however many layers you have, this one just has the strength fabric and the lining for my example. Actually, while we're doing that, go ahead and pass those out. You can, like, fiddle with it. See how those are constructed. So you start at the front and you'll install your busk. And when you're adding a panel, you take all of the layers, however many layers your corset is going to be, and place them right sides against the front, and then the back part, like the lining, or if you have two strength layers, then another strength layer in the lining back here, right side together. And then stitch all of the layers at one time into the seam. And then flip all everything. So that now you've got all the layers going forward. And then to put your bone in, all of the seam allowances are facing the same way now, on one side of the seam. And then you just will stop top stitch a line right next to the seam, and then top stitch and line the width away for your boning channel, and slide the bone in there. And now the bone is in this with all the seam allowances. So in this case, it's 6 layers of fabric. And you put your bone in there, and it's got multiple layers holding it in place, so it's not going to punch through. And you can construct the whole corset at the same time, so you don't have to line up seams from different layers. You don't have to worry about it not being stitched exactly the same, because you're stitching them at the same time. And I think it's really fast. So because you start at the front, you end at the back, and hey, it's done.
Okay, so just to be sure.
Yeah.
Front to front.
Yeah,
and the
right
front.
Right sides together. And here's the front of the corset. You would place it, you know, onto the previous panel. Right sides together. Here's your lining. Right side with the existing part of the corset. All your layers together, and then you just stitch down the seam all together.
I'm missing
some. Well, maybe if you look at it,
yeah,
if you want to handle it. Does everybody else sort of understand?
I'd like to see it.
Okay.
The end result is going to be similar to sandwich, but you're just piecing it together differently. Am I understanding that?
Yes, except you're going to have more seam allowances.
That's awesome. Okay.
There is, so the seams end up being bulkier. Okay. That's just one of the downsides is the seams and the boning channels are bulkier than it would be with the sandwich method, because most of the sandwich method corsets, you press the seams open.
Right. Okay.
And then, so in this way, all the seam allowances are pressed to one side.
Okay, gotcha.
So that means that basically there's more layers holding the bone in.
Yeah,
that's not. So the boning would be on one side of the seam.
It's on one side, your boning is on one side of the seam. That's the other problem, is it's difficult to do double boning. A bone on each side of the seam. You can add internal casings. You could slide extra casings, you know, in between your layers and stitch them that way, which I've done.
Yeah.
Or if you want bones in the middle of your panels. One of the problems with it also is that once you get to the end, all your bones are in place, everything is stitched. It's really hard to take it apart if you find out you need to make a change to the first panel, because then you have to start over.
Yeah.
But it's my favorite method because I think it's really quick and it's, it makes, it's precise because everything's done at the same time.
Yeah.
Everything matches up. Like you don't end up with it being bubbled.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes, you can trim the seam allowances if you want it to be
like
flatter. Or one of the seam allowances or something like that, which I've done. It depends on the fabric you're using, whether you need to do that or not, and personal preference, really.
So do you have a tutorial of this method on the website?
I do. There's a tutorial on my blog with pictures of it.
So you take pictures, I'm like...
No, yeah. And that's on my handout. I mean, my blog, I used to have a list of like all the tutorials I have, but that's a link that goes to a page that has a list of all my corset making tutorials, because it was getting ridiculous. But yes, I have a step-by-step photo tutorial of that on my blog, which should make more sense.
Yes.
There's also another one on here by Catafalque on her blog. She has a good tutorial of the same method. And that's why, I mean, without making a corset up here or having, like, a presentation, but really for more in-depth stuff, that's why I'm giving you all these links. So you can go look at it when you're actually looking at your corset and try to figure it out at home. Other questions on that? Or any of the construction methods? Everything?
It's kind of genius.
I know, I discovered it just by a community post of someone saying, hey, this is what I do, you know? And I'm like, that sounds interesting, that sounds really, like, it would eliminate some of the problems with the sandwich method and things like that. And I really don't like making corsets any other way. Sometimes I'll do an external channel for the look of it.
So how big do you make your seam allowances? Well, I guess it'd just be a little larger than a chain.
Yeah, I make them usually just kind of 5/8.
Yeah.
Which you don't have to make them as that big as if you're going to do other methods. But I just make sure my seam allowances are large enough to cover the bone, so that when I stitch my bone channel, they get caught in that second line of stitching.
Yeah.
If you were using larger bones, like a half-inch bone, then yeah, you're going to want to make them bigger.
Do you usually use quarter-inch?
I use quarter-inch, mostly. I just prefer it. I prefer the look of it. I'd rather use more bones than use quarter-inch, which is why I have this sitting around not doing anything.
Do you have any tips for adding the bust?
Yeah, obviously adding a bust is one of the more difficult parts of making a corset. The stud side is not that difficult, and you always do the stud side first. So in this example, obviously, I just sort of fold the seam allowances, fold it over, because this is just a long bag. But normally, you can either make it so that the first panel is on a fold, and it folds over like that. So that it has just a nice folded edge, or you can do where you have multiple layers and your lining and your front meets, so you have a seam right there. You can do it either way, personal preference, really.
And then you just use an awl.
And then I just use the awl to do that. So that side's pretty easy to get in, and then the tricky side is the other one. And you obviously have to make sure that you're lining them up correctly so that everything's going to line up. So usually they all mark, like you can see my little mark of where the bottom of my busk needs to go. And you can also see the marks of where my loops are going to come out. There's two ways to do this. You can do it with a seam, where you have a seam right here on the edge, and you stitch from here to here and then leave a gap, and then stitch from here to here and leave a gap, stitch. So you have these parts between two layers that are not stitched, and that's where your loops come out. And that's fine. If you have enough force, if you I would stitch that twice. Make sure you stitch them twice on that one, because otherwise your bust can pull out from that seam. If you just have one line of stitching holding it in, that's happened to me. The other way, which is stronger, and whether you like it or not, it's just personal preference, is to make button holes. Have this be a folded edge, so it comes in, you know, you have a double layer here in the first panel, or it folds under just around the busk, like, you know, it will fold under like that. And make button holes for your little loops to come out of. So you obviously that takes, you have to measure pretty precisely how big the button holes need to be, mark them, and make button holes for each one. But it is stronger because it's not going to pull through stitching and come out. But then you can also see the button holes. So that's a personal preference thing as well, whether you think that looks good or not. Okay. So we've got our corset constructed. And oh, with the folded seam method, once you get to the back, you've got your layers and you get to the back of the corset, then you would just fold both ends, the seam allowances in, and top stitch down that way to in the back. With this sandwich method, you attach the front and attach the back, stitch them, and then flip the corset inside out, because you haven't done any boning yet, and then that's when you add your boning. Make sense? But you can't do that with the folded seam because you've been stitching all your channels as you go. Finishing a corset, you know, you bind the edges of the corset, preferably with bias tape, because it stretches nicely around the curves. If you don't have a very curvy corset, like an underbust, it's just sort of straight. I've used just straight grain fabric strips to bind it. It worked fine. But if you have a very curvy edge like this, you definitely want bias tape.
There's an excellent bias tape tutorial on Foundations Revealed. I think it's free. And it's probably the best.
Sewing it on there?
Yeah, it's probably the best. It's a way where you don't have like wrinkles and anything for curves. It's really good.
Yeah, and it's somewhat, it's just a matter of doing it and getting used to stretching it enough so that it's not going to wrinkle. Line the edges up and stitch to the front with the machine. And then a lot of people fold it over and hand stitch it to the inside. I hate hand stitching. I'm really bad at it, so I don't. I will just, again, machine stitch it closed. And it's mostly a matter of practice of getting it so it's smooth, and make sure you hold it, you know, tight so that it wraps around nicely. And you can buy pre-made bias tape like satin, which is fine. I mean, you don't want to use the cheap stuff from the sewing store, obviously, the poly bias tape, but you can buy pre-made satin if you just want black edges, and I've used that and it's fine, or you can make your own bias tape from your fabric. And you don't need any kind of strength layer on that, just whatever your fabric is. We talked about the grommets, and we talked about what to lace with, how to lace the corset. There's different ways to do lacing. This is sort of the way that is most standard with the bunny ears. These are called bunny ears. And you start and you basically go over, under, so that you get crosses right here, and that way you can pull on the crosses to tighten that particular area of the corset. And you leave, you know, you come out here and go in, you want these right at your waist so that you can pull here, it tightens everything, and then you tie your bunny ears, and that's how you tie it. Make sense?
Another lacing method is to go across the top. How to describe it? You don't want to cross your lacing in between the boning, so you do it on the sides, and then when you cross on the top, bring it underneath.
Like, is it the ladder lacing?
No, it's not. I mean, you do see the X's, but the problem with bringing the lacing in between the boning
is that you can get some distortion.
Yeah, okay, I know what you mean. So because it can rub against the edge of the corset.
Right, it can rub. There's two things. One, the lacing can get warm because the pressure is coming on the lacing from the bust or the metal. And the other is that you can distort, depending on the metal, you can distort the metal. You can get it not lining up right. So you cross either below or above, and then you come straight down underneath typically and out, and then you cross. And then you come underneath.
I'm not really familiar with that one.
Yeah, but that's sort of underneath crossing, you go flat, and then you cross over, and then underneath it's
oh, yeah.
Right.
Like I said, there's a bunch of different ways that you can lace. There's and spiral lacing, which is more, you know, for historical horses, pre-Victorian. And sometimes it's a matter of preference. This is the sort of easiest way to get it on by yourself. And I have had, you know, like I said, I'm hard on my corsets. I've had corsets where this edge gets worn from, especially because when I'm wearing a corset during the day, I'll put it on for something and I'll take it off and I'll put it on and take it off like several times. So there's a lot of lacing going on. Mm-hmm. And I have had these back edges get worn by the corset lacing. And what I've done is, and I have a tutorial on the blog, but I've basically just taken strips and of coutil and reinforce that back edge and stitched it down like bias tape to give more life to my corset. It's not the prettiest thing in the world, but it definitely works. And that's the other thing is I've had problems with these bones at the back wearing through the bottom because also I'm curvy, so there's sort of a lot of stress on the bottom of the back lacing bones. As you can see, this one snapped off. Right there at the very end, because like this was on the back, and then you got curved and broke off right there.
Got some nice holes in the back.
In my sewing chair in the back, there's actually a worn, the fabric is worn away because I'll wear my corset out on the outside, sitting in the chair. So again, I've reinforced it with extra strips. You can also use flossing to reinforce your bone casings, which is decorative and functional embroidery over the bone casings. Again, I'm not good at hand sewing or embroidery, particularly.
You don't have to do it particularly fine. I have done that.
No, I've done it, and it's functional. It's not particularly pretty because I'm not neat.
Well, so who's going to see it? It's in the corset.
I know, but some people are wonderful, and they can make beautiful. I love the look of flossing when it's done, you know, really beautifully. It's great. But it does provide the function of holding the bone in place and reinforcing those tips. So that's another thing, another option. Another thing you can do or might want to do is make a modesty panel for the back of the corset and the front. I usually will make, like this one, has a little flap of fabric at the front for a front modesty panel so that it's not showing my skin, especially because I have these weird little lock latches here. There's a lot of gap in between, so I had to put something here to be decent. So usually that's just a flap. You can also put an extra bone for an underbusk to reinforce the front. Then the modesty panel at the back, especially if you're wearing, of course, those outerwear, you probably want to have a modesty panel. The best way to do it is a floating modesty panel. It's boned. Because if you bought a corset with a modesty panel, usually they're just a flap of fabric that's sewn on one side, and they get all bunched up, and you're constantly trying to pull it. So I make them, you can either make just a rectangle, however wide the gap is going to be in your corset, or some people make them so that they are hourglass shaped, so that there's room to, it doesn't get in the way of lacing tightly at the waist. And I just make them with, you know, the same fabric as I did the corset, the strength layer, and because there's no strain in the modesty panel, I'll use the cable ties for boning in them. And I'll usually do like kind of an H shape, bones on the side and then bones in the middle running horizontal so that it doesn't get crushed and it stays nice and flat. And this one has grommets. I actually need to change this, but it's got grommets for the laces to go through, so that it stays in place. You can also put loops of fabric to put the laces through. But that's the best way to do a lot of stuff. Okay, I think that's pretty much it that I have. So questions or problems you had with Corset, specific things? Yes.
My problem is with a custom fit, because I, like you, I have to have something custom, otherwise it hurts. My hip to rib ratio is almost a full inch different on one side as the other.
Okay.
And it is a bitch to figure out how to get, how to do a proper fit.
Asymmetry issues, and that's actually, I'm dealing with that on this one because I've got breast asymmetry, and also one hip is higher than the other,
yeah,
which is fairly common. It's really kind of a process of mock-ups. You know, like, I mean, basically what I did is I said, okay, I'm going to, on my pattern, bring the hip in sooner on one side. And you have to have a left side pattern and a right side pattern.
Okay,
you know.
Because I have, on my left side, is this beautiful little wasp waisty little look, and on the other side, it's so, like, trying to figure out how to get the other side, they get as much, you know, reduction in the right place.
Because there's not as much room on that side?
Because on the long side, because there's more room.
Okay.
And it just doesn't, I've never been able to get it, to get a good fit in order to match the curve on the other side. Because it's shorter.
Right. That's trying to get to match when
that's
interesting.
Otherwise, I end up with like this on the side and this on the side.
Because you can kind of squish, you know, down your hip. If you try making the waist longer on your short side,
okay,
so it kind of pushes down on your hip, so it kind of gives you a look of it being longer.
Something that you could also play with might be...
Because if you drop the waist, because I usually tend to put my waist pretty low,
okay,
and this isn't the best example, of course, but, you know, if you put it lower, you can kind of give yourself a lower look, hip look.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
Or she wants the hip higher, she could play with maybe putting...
You
like
can
a
also
shoulder
use
pad.
Yeah.
Like a shoulder pad on the flatter side.
Yeah, and that's been done for hips. You can add some little padding or quilted kind of.
Okay.
Yeah, you know, just like a slight thing on one side of the hip.
Okay.
And that's like historically accurate. The Victorians used padding in their
hips
to give them their shape that they wanted.
Yeah.
I think my problem, and I think we've talked about this in the past, Maggie, is I feel like my rib cage is higher on, like.
Yeah.
And
mm-hmm.
One half of you.
Yeah,
one half of you. It's like way up
here. Yeah, most of the time I look at, I'm like, am I standing crooked? Because my hips, and that's what this corset, I basically made one side lower on the hips than the other side. I started the waist sooner,
okay,
like I'm saying, and I, so then I was like, hey, I look like I'm standing straight for once, because the hips are at the same level. You know what
well, the other thing is, most people do not have perfectly symmetrical bodies.
No.
And it is not uncommon to have one leg longer than the other, and thereby having your hips look like the different heights. So if you find that's the case, you can play with visual tricks.
Yeah, and like I said, I've been trying to deal with breast asymmetry, trying to get those sort of ones not falling out.
Yes.
But that's,
so
I mean, that's very
important. I am a little feature rich.
Mm-hmm.
And I
know that one. So, okay, I'm not laughing at you. I'm laughing with you.
Even with a corset, I'll wear a cami, and sometimes I'll even wear a bra.
I've heard women say that. I don't think if you have it properly fitted that you need to.
Yeah.
I mean,
I just don't like movement.
Well, if you have a problem fitted, no one's moving.
But the cami kind of protects.
Well, that's fine. I think that, yeah. Wearing a cami or
even a tube top
if you don't
want
to. Yeah, they make actual they're called
bandeaus.
Yeah, but there's actually a corset specific name and I'm just blanking on it. Corset liners, which is basically it only has one seam at the back, and you can make it out of just whatever little stretch fabric usually. and it has a seam at the back, and it's just topless. It's just like a little tube top to go under a corset to keep the corset clean. But yeah.
It's in the south, we sweat.
I trust me, sweat. I'm in costume outside all the time. Yeah. And I usually do wear a tank top under my corsets, like when I'm not in costume.
Definitely under bust.
Oh, yes, if you're going to wear an underbust, please wear a bra. I know that probably most people here know that, but some people don't know that.
Too many don't.
And it's not a good look.
If you're larger than a bee.
Oh, yeah. Honey, even if you're a bee.
I mean, some people can get away with no bra, but most of us don't.
Yeah, bees can still sag just like everybody else.
It makes them look sad. Yeah, it's very sad. You may want to wear a bra without an underwire, though, if you're wearing an underbust, because sometimes the underbust can press up and press on the underwire. I've actually got a bruise on my ribs because of that, and it was from the bra, not the corset, but it was the way that the corset pushed up on the bra. And it was a corset that wasn't broken in yet, so it was like very stiff. So yeah, if you're going to wear a lot of underbust, which a lot of people do for weights training or wear under their clothes for back support, probably you want a non-underwire bra.
I can't even conceive of buying a non-underwire
bra. I know. It's a little strange, but it's better. You can also make your underbust come shorter and not come all the way up, if so it doesn't have that problem.
Also, if you're against feature rich, you should not be wearing a flat front corset.
No, there really should be curve. And you can, and if on the pattern to make a nice curve, you know, you want it to have a nice curve out and then curve back in. Because otherwise you're just sort of like shooting out like that. But you want it to have a curve back in so it's more settled against your skin. So you're not falling out. And you're not. It's more attractive. Yes?
I am not exactly what you call flat. I'm a 36 triple D. And I have a corset, a Victorian corset, that I have danced in, and I do not need, you know, for 8 hours a day.
Right.
And I do not need to wear a bra with it. I do, you know, because, and I have bent over from the hip, sort of teasing a guy. And I don't fall out.
Yeah, I mean,
if it's really properly fit, you don't need any other underwear because it is the underwear.
Right, and I mean, you know, you might want to add more boning to it if you're not having enough support.
I've got lots of boning in it.
And you may also need to bring the top up, which is a problem. Like, I always have to add it. And I have one corset that I didn't add enough to, and if I were to bend over, then that is going to be problematic. I'm going to actually add some ribbon to the top to try to prevent that. But also, if you know that you have a long waist, a long torso, when you're starting out with your corset pattern, you probably want to go ahead at the waist and add an inch, add 2 inches. You know, I always have to add. Or if you know you're particularly short-waisted, you may need to take out. But those are the kind of things that if you know about yourself, you can just go ahead and do. I always add to the top and the bottom of my corsets, and because I figure I can always cut it back. If it ends up being too long, even when I make my final corset, like this one's very long, I figure if it's too high under the underarms or something, I can cut it back on the final one before I do the binding to exactly how I want it, but you can't add, so I always try to add extra, especially in the bust to prevent those kinds of problems. Other questions? Okay. Well, it's 11:30, so... I guess we can do it.